Hi guys, welcome back to the channel where today I want to talk to you guys about something very near and dear indeed. I want to talk to you about the longest single running luxury SUV line in the entire history of the automotive world. I also want to talk to you guys about the vehicle that went on to create the luxury SUV. That's right, today I want to give you guys a verbal history of the Range Rover. Born in the shadows of the Land Rover, which was first introduced in 1948 as a mechanical horse that you could kind of drive on the road, it was based originally on a Jeep Willys, but the thing about that is it wasn't very refined. And by sort of the early 1950s, Land Rover was starting to get worried that their beautiful sport utility vehicle may start to sell less models as the years go forward, and that people may want something a little bit more refined. Now, out of this, in 1951, Gordon Bashford came up with this idea for something that kind of might eventually become the Range Rover. They called it, at the time, the Road Rover. Originally designed to look more like a station wagon than what would go on to be the beginning of the luxury SUV. The Road Rover was refined so much that by 1956, it was internally called the Mark II, before even being brought to market. And by 1958, the project was so long in tooth that it ended up being canceled just months before making it to market. Now, you flash forward to the early 1960s, and Rover firmly had their eyes on the American market. Vehicles now like the Bronco and the Jeep Wagoneer were coming to market, and they saw there was a demand there for what some might consider sport utility vehicles. So Sven King was brought in to help with the vehicle's engineering, and they determined from a very, very, very early stage that this vehicle was going to be the first one ever as a series production car to have full-time four-wheel drive. So they came up with some advancements in that field and allowed the vehicle to have drive powered to each of all of the four wheels, whereas other vehicles on the market were either rear-wheel drive or they were lockable four-wheel drive on rough terrain. It was also be equipped with a special long-travel independent suspension that could handle pretty much anything you could throw at it. This thing was going to be capable beyond imagination. The Range Rover's now iconic design actually started off kind of as a mistake. Early on, members of the engineering team designed these rudimentary panels that sort of went around the outside of the vehicle. And they were designed specifically to have people, prying eyes perhaps, not see the actual final project. And interestingly enough, the project head saw the design they came up with, and he actually instructed them to move forward with this as the final design because he liked it so much. All they were to do was just sort of make some minor changes to this, and then it would actually go to be the final design for the Range Rover. So in the end, they ended up having to fire the person who was tasked with designing the actual Range Rover project. Kind of embarrassing on the grand scheme of things. By 1967, what would eventually go on to be the Range Rover had finally the go-ahead from Rover. And the next 2 years, they used to stress test the final product and really just throw it through all number of different adverse conditions. And publicly, they showed off how the vehicle was going through these adverse conditions. And it was really interesting because, you know, prior to going on sale as 1970, in 1970, this was sort of like a very new way of marketing a vehicle as well. And this is eventually what they brought to market. In the year 1970, they introduced formally the Range Rover. It was almost immediately sold out in its home market. And as more of the world had the chance to experience the Range Rover charm, it racked up countless awards. One interesting little bit of history is the French loved the Range Rover so much, and they thought that it was such an incredible piece of modern design, go figure, they ended up actually placing one inside the Louvre as a piece of modern art. That's something that I can't say I've heard about many other vehicles. You know, a couple other English ones actually do come to mind, but that is quite a statement, especially from the French. It wasn't long before Land Rover teamed up with the famous fashion house Vogue and created the Range Rover and Vogue, which to this day, if you buy a Range Rover in continental Europe or in the United Kingdom or many parts of the world, it is still called the En Vogue. Interesting. This marked a turning point for the Range Rover, one where the upper middle class sought it out as a style item. These same early trendsetters also had a panache for the finer things and would eventually begin to shape the actual Range Rover luxury credentials and the fact that the Range Rover started going into this direction of luxury goods. Now, I'm gonna take a moment to just mention that by the year 1970, the Range Rover was still only available in certain markets, not the United States market, and it was only available in a three-door guise. It was only actually 1982 that they introduced the Range Rover four-door as a permanent model, not a limited edition, and it was 1987 where they brought the vehicle to the United States market. Yes, that's right. It took 17 years before Land Rover could make enough of the darn things to actually get the vehicle across the pond to America, the country that they had always intended on selling the vehicle in. By this point, it wasn't long before the Mark II came around. The Mark II came out in 1994, and interestingly enough, that vehicle also became the underpinnings of the BMW X5, because BMW acquired Land Rover in the year 1994. It's also worth mentioning that BMW and Mercedes finally kind of clued in to the fact that that upper middle class in the Americas liked the high riding driving position of the sport utility vehicle, and they liked it in a luxury format. And in the year 1998, the ML and X5 formally came out on the market, a full 28 years after Range Rover was first introduced. Talk about being late to the party. Mercedes was in fact so worried that the ML would not be rough and tough enough for the demographic that the Range Rover grew in, that they actually reinstated a military vehicle and crafted it up as the G-Class we know and love today. And another interesting fact, that luxury liner, the G-Wagon, was only introduced to the American market in the year 2001. So it does have a long and illustrious history, but primarily as vehicles that are used by the military. The Canadian military, in fact, still use G-Classes to this day. So 2001 was the first year that was available to market. Kind of neat. Now on its fourth generation, it's plain to see that the Range Rover really introduced the entire luxury class of super luxury SUVs. It's also a vehicle that has been the choice of celebrities, it's been the choice of royals, and it's incredible to think the Range Rover has now had a continuous production run of 50 years. That's right, 50 years. So, long and short, long live the Range Rover. If you've driven one and you have any input on it, if you love your Range Rover, drop it in the comments below. If you have any questions or comments, or if you have suggestions for future videos, please drop that down below, guys. And remember, like, comment, subscribe. There'll be plenty more to come in the coming days. Cheers!